Hi, I'm Jessica LeGros. I am a fourth grade teacher at Carpenter Elementary. And Emily asked if I would talk a little bit about how I used building thinking classrooms in my math class with my fourth graders last year. So how I got started, actually started with a PD in the fall that I watched virtually. And then I bought the book. So the first half of the school year, they've been dabbling in some of this stuff using vertical surfaces, working on word problems where the kids worked in groups. So I've been dabbling in some of it, but I hadn't really implemented it fully. So after taking some time to read the book, about halfway through the school year, I decided to jump in with both feet and really just redo my whole math program. So I started implementing all of the different principles in here full force. And it was wonderful because I had Emily at my building last year. So she was able to help implement it, came in and co-taught with me during the week. And that was a real treat. So here are some of her questions that she thought I should address. What worked for you in building thinking classrooms and what didn't? I will say there were some things I couldn't fully implement last year just because of COVID protocols. So instead of having random groups daily, I had them working in pods where they were with the same group for a period of time. That definitely was not as good as random groups, simply because they kind of got irritated working with the same people every single day and were ready to work with new people. So I'm excited to hopefully be able to this year be able to randomize groups on a daily basis. The other thing that happened when I couldn't do random groups every day is certain kids would kind of be the take charge kids who would want to do everything. And then there would be the kids who would kind of want to stand back, where being able to do randomized groups on a daily basis, I think would take care of that problem. Because you know, maybe you're working with a kid one day who really likes to be in control and do all the problem. But then the next day you're with a different group and now you're going to be more involved. So those were some of the things that didn't work. What really did work though was their motivation. Like they were excited to do math. They were excited to get up and move around and not be sitting at their desks, especially since so much of their day was sitting in one spot last year, again, because of protocols. They liked working with other people. They liked having the conversations. They liked the fact that once they realized it wasn't cheating to look around at what someone else was doing to get ideas, they loved, you know, gosh, if I get stuck, I can just turn and look at what somebody else is doing and I can get some ideas without feeling like I'm floundering by myself, not knowing what to do. So all of that really helped. Also, what worked for me is I didn't have to come up with places to search out great performance task problems for the kids to work on. They're already in our math series. So I was picking and choosing different problems for the math series. So instead of working on 10, 15, 20 problems in a day, they worked on one or two, but had a lot more depth to it. What was I initially worried about when implementing building thinking classrooms? I think what I was worried about at first was how are these randomized groups going to go? You know, I've done lots of work with kids before, and then you get the grunting and the, oh, I'm frustrated that I'm working with this person. The beautiful thing about the groups changing often is that is eliminated because they know, oh, okay, I'm working with maybe somebody that my personality doesn't mesh with today, but tomorrow I'm going to be with somebody else. So it's going to be, it's okay. So actually the randomized groups was a really, really great thing, where at first I was worried that it was going to be a fight daily. The other thing I was worried about was assessment, especially with them doing so much group work. I was a little worried, am I going to be able to tell what they're capable of individually on their own? And actually, the way this was set up with them going off and working in groups and me being able to sometimes stand back and watch from afar at each of the groups and see what they're doing, and also going in and conferring with each group, I actually feel that I knew more on a deeper level what they were each capable of based on the conversations I was having with them than on something they would turn into me at the end of class where I am just seeing algorithms. So where I was a little bit worried I wasn't going to know how they were doing, I actually feel like I got better information with this system because they were able to talk to me out loud about their thinking. So it wasn't just seeing how they solved the problem, but actually understanding how they went about it and their thinking behind it. How long did it take for my students to get used to this and how did they respond to it? I would say it probably took a good month to get used to the routines. The way I kind of started going about it is I worked at implementing like one routine a week really, really well. So I first just started with randomized groups and then the vertical whiteboard surfaces. And then I started working on implementing the other parts. So I kind of went about it by trying to get really implementing one thing kind of at a time, but at a week at a time. They really responded to it well. It was kind of neat because I used the same protocol during summer school. And I had three students from my class and then students from a lot of other schools. And they that was only a 4-week program. And I felt like within a week, they were really feeling pretty good about the protocol. So part of it was me getting better at it too and kind of playing around with how I wanted to make this work and how I wanted to implement different routines and making changes. So once I kind of got a feel for what I felt worked for my teaching style, then the second time around, it was implemented much quicker. What changes did I see in my students after I implemented this? Especially for my kids who struggle with math or tend to look at themselves as not being a student with a lot of a math skill, I really feel like this built confidence in them, especially focusing on the modeling aspect of the math work that they were doing and realizing that drawing a picture and creating a model of the math problem that you're doing is what all mathematicians do. And so once they realized that, they didn't look at that as a downside, they looked at that as a positive. And then the fact that that every kid was expected to model their thinking, then that helped them also as they looked around to see, oh, okay, I can do math just like everyone else can. So it was very much a confidence builder, especially for my kids that would look at themselves as struggling math students. They became much better at collaboration. They had to work together. They had to help each other. And in their group, if they couldn't come up with the proper strategies to help them, then they were looking to other groups to help give them ideas. So that collaborative piece and knowing to ask for help and being able to communicate, okay, I think this is the way to go about this. And that really grew. Their assessments grew, getting them to realize that these same strategies you use in your group, you can now use on your individual assessment. So you can still draw a model and use that to figure out which way, how to solve the problem, which operation you might want to use, or sometimes drawing a picture, they didn't even have to do that step. They also really grew in giving each other feedback. So at the share part of class, at the end of class, some days we would do a gallery walk where they would just go and look at other student strategies. Some days they would take sticky notes and give feedback. Here's one thing your group did really, really well. Here's one thing that you might want to do next time so that your thinking is easier to understand. So sometimes they gave that kind of feedback. Sometimes students, I would have students share their thinking with the whole group. So we kind of changed up how that share went each day. But being able to give each other feedback, being able to take feedback, and also being able to speak publicly about their thinking, all of those things really, really grew. And probably one of the best parts, how did building thinking classrooms make my life easier as a teacher? It was way less prep to get ready for teaching math of the day. If I was meeting in small groups in math previously, as I'm meeting with one group, I needed to have things for the rest of the group to do. And then those things that the rest of the group was doing as I was meeting with my small group, I would need to give some kind of feedback on all of that work. Otherwise, they weren't going to do it or work on it the way that they should. So it, that kind of setup of center-based math learning was a lot more work for me. I had to do a lot of prep to have all of the materials ready for them, had to get the timer set, had to have a way for kids to move around the classroom to go to each of the centers, had to have small group lesson ready for me to teach, and then also then afterwards collecting all of that information, giving feedback on it. So that was a lot of work. Now with math, I have every group working on the same two or three problems in a period. And as they're working, I'm going around and meeting with each of the groups. And so I'm, all of my prep is done for everybody at once, but every kid is still challenged. Those students who maybe struggle with math a little bit, they're gonna be better maybe at the modeling side of creating the problem. And those kids that are higher, they're gonna be ready and better with the creating an equation or an algorithm to solve the problem. And then those higher kids, if they have a student in their group that is kind of struggling with not knowing how to go about doing the work, now they get to be in the role of teacher and talking kids through it and asking them questions and what they think they should do. And then also my high kids have always done really well with, yep, this is how I solve it. I just did it in my head, but they could had a, maybe struggled with explaining their thinking. In order for them to really truly do the work of the day, they need to, after they've modeled the problem, solved the problem, then they need to explain what they did with words. And so each student was challenged in a different way with what was expected to them to do in group work. And so it was hitting on every level, and every kid was able to be challenged and grow with this setup without me creating different assignments for each kid. So the other thing that was really nice is each day I didn't have to spend a whole bunch of time looking at their daily work of what they did for the day, because I was doing that work while class was in session, while I was moving around from group to group. Previously, I'd normally be during, after I did my mini lesson and send them off to work. And then I would usually be working with the kids who needed the most support. So I'm helping them. And then so the other kids who maybe I didn't get the chance to meet with as much or as long, then I'm looking at all of their work later to see, did we get this? Did we not get this, before moving on to the next day? So now instead of taking all of that work home to look at and see, what do I need to do for the next day? I'm seeing all of that happen in real time. So I know during our math session that hour, I'm seeing everything that they're doing. I'm getting to talk to them about their thinking, and I'm able to make a plan for the next day of what I notice they need. Being able to confer and answer their questions in real time too, I feel like that allowed me to hit all of my kids. I feel like so often, those really strong kids are the ones who are kind of missing out on having some one-on-one instruction with me. But in this setup, I feel like every kid is getting their needs met, and I'm able to confer with each kid, and I'm able to take time to meet with those kids who are struggling, also meet with those kids who are kind of in the middle, and also meet with those kids on the higher end mathematically, and teach into what each of their needs mean. Even if there's one of all three in the same group, I can teach into what each of them need in a really quick amount of time where they all can get what they need. So this setup made a huge difference for that. I felt like I wasn't always able to meet what all of my kids needed. And I felt like some groups of kids got left out too often. But with these principles, I really felt as if I was getting to all of my kids in the way that they deserved. And finally, I think the part that's most important is previously, yep, I'm doing the mini lesson, I'm doing the teaching, and then I'm sending them off to work independently, and I'm coming around and trying to help. But in all of that, the way I used to teach math, I was doing all the heavy lifting. I was doing all the hard work. I was doing the, and a lot of times the kids, when you send them off independently, they would sit and wait for me to come around until they got the support that they needed to start trying and start working. Now, with the way the groups are set up, with the way that they have so many strategies to get help as they need it, they're doing the heavy lifting and they're getting the help they need from each other, as opposed to me being the only one who can get them going and get them started. So the one thing I will absolutely say about building thinking classrooms is I will never go back to teaching math any other way. I did a book study this summer on culturally responsive teaching, and a big part of that was being the warm, a warm demander type of teacher, where you know, they get that kindness and empathy from you, but you're also really pushed to do the work that is hard. And I feel like building thinking classrooms is the way to absolutely do that for all of our kids. If you have any questions at all, don't hesitate to reach out to me. I'm happy to meet with anyone and share my experiences if your questions didn't get answered. But it's a really, really exciting way to teach math. It's better for teachers, and most importantly, better for our students. Have a great day and a great school year.